Down every street in Australia, there is an invisible danger so ubiquitous we no longer even notice it's there. What is it? It's electricity. And the only things keeping it at a safe distance from us are power poles, mostly wooden poles. It's been like that since we first harnessed electricity. Here in South Australia, we went further than the simple wooden pole. An engineer named James Cyril Stobie designed a whole new way to support power lines in 1924. Naturally, they named it after him and called it the Stobie Pole. 2024 marks the 100th anniversary of the Stobie Pole, a milestone that is a testament to its resilience. But why did South Australia need its own pole, so different from those used in every other part of the world? And how has it become an icon for South Australians? South Australians are proud to call this place home. We love our footy, our festivals, and our fine food and wine. Our ritual feats, our defining treats, and all the things only a South Australian would understand.
Every South Australian knows what a Stobie pole is. You know, people interstate probably don't, but we do, and it is something that we can say that's uniquely something that is South Australian. It's part of us.
That's Paul. He worked at SA Power Networks for 16 years. He might be a little biased, I know, but he is onto something here. With more than 650,000 of them across the state, it's one of the few constants in the background of all of our lives. How could it not influence us in some way?
I think we find inspiration in what's in our community. That's a really strong force for artists and songwriters and poets. And everyone knows the Stobie. And it's got a presence in the community that sets it up to be a platform for art and for expression.
Unfortunately, not everyone loves the Stobie pole like we do. Some would prefer to bury power lines underground or hide them in trees. But whether they're an eyesore or an icon really is in the eye of the beholder, and perhaps also comes down to where you live.
A lady who lives in the street suddenly realised that she didn't have a Stobie pole in front of her house. And she said, oh, I wish I had a Stobie pole in front of my house, because she really loved them, as all of the street do. And it's something that really makes our community.
Cheryl is the coordinator of the Greening Hindmarsh Group, a community of mosaic enthusiasts situated north of the city parklands. They catch up every Sunday to plan new designs and artworks to beautify their neighbourhood, which includes over 30 stunning Stobie pole artworks.
When we first started doing Stobie pole art, it was a very industrial area. For us, it's actually about the aesthetic value and linking our community together that is important to us. We've got the Bowden Bird Walk in Sala this year, and what we want is the community to come to Bowden, get a cup of coffee, enjoy the time with their friends, enjoy what we think is just beautiful artwork.
Okay, I know what you're thinking. It's the art that's made them beautiful, not the pole. But let's be honest, without that blank canvas of iron and concrete, would the art have been brought to life?
Egypt has a sphinx, Jordan digs its Petra, but our Stobie's better, right here down under, eighth wonder of the world.
I had to write a song about the Stobie pole. I've been writing songs about South Australia and Adelaide, its people and history, and it's such an icon, it really does deserve a song. When I started writing the song, I certainly wasn't thinking about the eighth wonder of the world, but it came pretty quickly. You know, comparing it with the Parthenon is a bit silly, but it is about also kind of recognising in the community it does have iconic status, and it's served us so well, and hey, it's his 100th birthday, why not celebrate?
So lift your glass to Cyril, a man who's made his mark in wonderful perfection, his powerful erection keeps us from the dark. It keeps us from the dark.
When electricity first started lighting up the streets of Adelaide in 1895, it was so profound that large crowds would marvel and gather in anticipation for a countdown, flick of a switch. It was an electrifying time, and naturally, everyone wanted a piece of this modern wonder. From 1904 to 1914, the number of customers grew by over 2,000%, creating an enormous growth in infrastructure works. It was around this time, in 1916, that James Cyril Stobie joined the Adelaide Electric Supply Company and soon started looking for new ways to distribute power. You see, South Australia isn't well known for its abundance of tall, straight trees suitable for carrying power. And at the time, they were forced to import wooden power poles at great expense. But there was another problem too.
This is a section of a hardwood wooden pole.
Meet Jeff, retired 39-year ETSA veteran and volunteer at the Sir Thomas Playford ETSA Electricity Museum.
Now, the pole is solid, it's heavy, it's a hardwood, but the termites love it too. And that's one of the reasons that Cyril had to invent the Stobie pole.
Cyril, as he was known, made use of the abundance of material South Australia had on hand, concrete and steel. When he revealed his idea, it was such a hit amongst his engineering colleagues, they lobbied for the company to buy Cyril's patent, striking a deal for a modest £500. That's approximately $50,000 in today's money. On his original patent, he describes his invention as an improved pole adapted to be used for very many purposes, but particularly for carrying electric cables. But would you believe it, it was also designed with comfort in mind.
His whole idea was to make a robust pole that could stand the climate of South Australia and was not noisy by having holes in it that the wind whistled through. By having two poles with steel braces was a concept used in New South Wales, but they were called a whistling willy, and they whistled in a 15 knot breeze.
Just imagine streets full of whistling willies.
Cyril looked at that and said it's not acoustically sound.
Thank goodness, but the design still had some bugs.
The linesmen were complaining about the poles walking out the ground, and that was due to the Bay of Biscay soil drying out in summer, swelling in winter, and lifting the pole out the ground. So he had another look at the plans and came up with the bend in the bottom of the pole, and they tapered, and now they don't lift out the ground anymore.
Which was quite fortunate, because between 1946 and 1965, the proportion of South Australians connected to the grid increased from 70% to 96%, driving Stobie pole manufacturing to an all-time peak. Playford-era development, post-war industrialisation, migration, and the continued electrification of rural towns meant that in 1962 alone, 30,000 poles were manufactured in facilities across the state. That's compared to an average of 2,000 a year today at the Angle Park facility in Adelaide.
I did a stint as a third year apprentice in 66 down at the pole yard at Angle Park. It was the maximum production period, and the production line was a quarter of a mile long, and we had motorbikes to get from one end to the other. As a third year apprentice, it was good fun.
James Cyril Stobie was known to have a great sense of fun, a sharp mind and a keen eye on the future. Sadly, he passed in 1953, never having witnessed the full electrification of our state and economy. But through his uniquely South Australian innovation, down every street, his legacy and his name lives on. There are power poles, and then there are Stobie poles.
I think what makes a good power pole is something that's cost effective to make, safe and reliable.
I think you want it to be not too expensive to get in place, and also you want it to be easy to work with.
A good Stobie pole is a straight one that hasn't jumped out in front of a car.
The Stobie pole, apart from perhaps being a reminder to drive safely, is an engineered product designed for South Australia's tough and varied conditions. They can withstand storms, floods, fire, rot and termites, and with maintenance, many will last a century. For a power pole, there is no equal in Australia for combined longevity and strength. So it's worth digging deeper to fully understand why. But first, let's discover how they're made.
The most common pole that you would see around metropolitan areas and in small country towns is the WB0905. So that's a 9 metre beam and 100 TFB steel.
That's Brian. He's been at SA Power Networks for 46 years and he's been making Stobie poles for 33 of those. He describes the manufacturing process as...
We bring in two rails at the start of the process. The rails are straightened, they're paired, we put the bend in them, they are turned over, placed on the empty pallets, bolts are installed, they're filled with concrete, they're cured and put in a storage area, and then they're issued by truck to site.
Okay, so they're fairly simple to construct, but there's a lot more to the engineering than meets the eye. For your typical 7-metre suburban Stobie, they will withstand a top force against it of 400 kilograms on the strong side and 100 kilograms on the weak, with those forces coming from things like crossarm and transformer attachments, any lateral tension from power lines, wind pressure, and even the weight of the pole itself. The steel beams provide tensile strength to resist the forces of bending. The concrete provides compressive strength to resist against the steel beams buckling together. But it's the bolts that are key. They distribute buckling pressure throughout the pole and are used to reinforce where the stresses become increasingly greatest.
The strength is in the bottom of the pole where the bolts are. But the big one might have 70 bolts in it. You might have 40 of the bolts in the bottom 2 metres.
Most of the stress forces act on the pole at or below ground, and this is where the footings become just as important as the pole itself.
The poles are placed in the footing, stood up, set square, and then they pour sharp sand in, and the sand locks the pole in the footing, and it basically becomes the one item. The load on the pole will push into the sand, which will push onto the former. The footing and the pole make the Stobie pole, make it as strong as it is.
Looking back on the original design patent of 100 years ago, the Stobie has changed over the years, but it is still unquestionably Cyril's pole. In his original patent, he describes the Stobie as an improved pole adapted to be used in many purposes. And so you get the sense that he had a practical outlook for his invention and would have been pleased to see it adapt and evolve over time. Now, as we look forward towards another 100 years of the Stobie pole, can we assume it has a future? Can it continue to service the needs of South Australians? Will it continue to adapt? Back in 1946, when Cyril Stobie and a couple of his mates renewed the patent for the Stobie pole, their goal was to profit from the sale of the manufacturing rights, and they even hired an agent to lobby on their behalf. Initially, they did have interest too, from as far as the US and the UK, but ultimately it was to no avail. Unfortunately, most believed that Stobie would rust, have a short lifespan, and not be economical. How wrong they were.
You look at the big picture, South Australia, our network is the most efficient in Australia. And you'd have to think that at least part of that's because of the Stobie pole.
That's Mark, Chief Operating Officer at SA Power Networks.
It costs roughly about $20,000 to put in a brand new Stobie pole. And it's about $15,000 or so to put in a brand new wooden pole. So not that much difference considering how long they last compared to the wooden poles.
According to Energy Safe Victoria, the average lifespan of timber poles is 53 years, of which 50% of the deterioration is due to rot, something the Stobie is immune to. And even with the comparable risk of rust, the Stobie pole lasts a lot longer.
We've got lots of poles that are stamped as 1930s, and they're still going strong. They will last way more than 100 years, no problem.
This potentially makes the Stobie pole up to 30% more economical as a pole solution compared to timber. But to be fair to Victoria...
Once you've established a standard for something like a Stobie pole, it's really hard to move away from it because all your designs, all your construction methods, your drawings, your parts, everything is actually designed around that.
Comparisons aside, there is movement away from poles altogether, as all new housing estates have their power buried underground. And many believe this is the inevitable destination for power networks. Except the truth is...
In South Australia, we've got about 70,000 kilometres of overhead network, and it costs something like about $1,000 a metre to underground that. $70 billion. I don't think that's going to happen somehow.
Okay, so the Stobie pole makes good economic sense, but the role they play is changing in some big ways. When the first Stobie poles were being installed on South Terrace, their purpose was to carry power from a single source out to homes and businesses. Today, driven in large part by rooftop solar, the distribution game is starting to look very different.
We picture a future where lots of people have got smart homes. They've got energy management systems, plenty of solar, a battery, electric vehicle. Most of the time though, they'll have lots of surplus energy that can be used for to power apartment buildings or heavy industry. And that's of course where the Stobie pole comes in. That's what's going to allow us, our Stobie pole network, to carry that energy from customers and their households and power the state.
Just as the Stobie pole took its place in South Australia's first power revolution, so too will it take its place in the next, connecting not just power, but you, me, and everyone else. Electricity supply and the humble Stobie pole have been central to many periods of development and growth for South Australia. They are central to our economic, social, and community activity. So as we celebrate the Stobie pole's 100th year in service and we look beyond for 100 more, we can confidently say our Stobie is here to stay.